Happy Mother's Day to all of you out there in the land of virtual land. We just thank you for joining us this morning. We're here to praise and worship an unstoppable God. We just ask that you praise us, praise with us this morning. Put your hands together, sing if you're comfortable. We just look forward to this time of worship this morning.
Unstoppable God, that your You sustain us, Lord. You provide for us, Lord.
Jesus,
hallelujah. Storm surrounding me, let it break at your name. Still call the sea to still, the rage in me to still, every wave at your name. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, breathe, call these bones to live, call these lungs to sing once again. I will pray. Praise you with our mouths. Hallelujah.
Oh, good morning and happy Mother's Day, ladies. We are delighted that you chose to join us and worship with us this morning. What a wonderful day to glorify and exalt the name of Jesus Christ. He certainly has blessed us with a wonderful day outside weather-wise, and I pray that you will indeed just have a very enjoyable day as we celebrate motherhood and looking forward to indeed what God has in store. You've heard me share on numerous occasions about, because of your faithfulness and your giving, how we've been able to bless others as well, as far as families and individuals and other smaller churches in our region. And I just wanted to share with you today a thank you note from Stonebridge Community Church down in Natural Bridge, Virginia. It says, to Jeff Ferguson and the church at Harrisonburg First Assembly of God, we were both touched and blessed by your generosity. As our family and church navigate these unprecedented times, it's amazing to see how God takes care of our every need. We know that you have been used in this process, and we pray God's blessing on you for your faithfulness. Thanks again, Pastor Ray and Wendy Newton, Stonebridge Community Church. Just wanted to share that with you and let you know that folks are definitely being touched and impacted in a positive way. And I'm thankful that we can all work together as God's children in blessing and honoring the Lord and passing on the blessings that God has given to us as well. We also want to encourage you to stay in tune today. At the end of the message this morning, we're going to be sharing with you. I'm sure that most of you are aware that this past week that Governor Northam had announced that churches can reopen at 50% capacity as of May the 15th, which is Friday. So we will be announcing about what we plan to do next Sunday morning on May the 17th. So you'll want to stay tuned and hear that. And again, we're just believing and trusting God for great and wonderful things as we continue to navigate our way through this COVID-19 virus. Well, today I want to speak to you on the subject of a mother's prayers, powerful and priceless. In 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 27, Hannah is offering up a prayer to the Lord after God has answered her petition and her request to have a child. When she indeed had given birth to Samuel, she said this, "For this child I prayed, and the Lord has granted me my petition, which I ask of him." This past Thursday, we observed the National Day of Prayer as a nation. And the theme this year was Pray God's Glory Across the Earth. In this present state of pandemic, I would like to think that individuals are praying more than ever before. And among the prayers that are being offered, there is something special about the prayers of a mother that are powerful and are priceless. I dread to think where I would be today if it had not been for the prayers of my mother and my grandmothers. I can remember on several occasions hearing my mother praying for me and for my siblings, and the same with my grandmothers when I would spend time with them in the summer. How many of you would say along with me, thank God for praying mothers? So again, ladies, happy Mother's Day. We are so thankful for all of you and for all that you do for us. We are truly blessed to have you in our lives, and I pray that you will know how much you are appreciated, not only today, but every day. I have to share this with you. Before the service this morning, our praise team leader, Crystal, was sharing with me that earlier this morning, her children had come into their bedroom, and her oldest, Skylar, had said, "Happy days, happy Mother's Day, Mommy." And about 30 seconds later, River said, "Happy Father's Day." She said it lasted all of 30 seconds. And I'm sure that there probably are those of you that are out there that probably think that, that only on Mother's Day or maybe for a minute or two or what have you, are you really appreciated. But I want you to know we are so thankful for each and every one of you. You know, how many of you would agree with me that every person leaves a legacy by training the next generation? And moms are a great example of this. Moms, whether you realize it or not, you have a tremendous influence upon your children. You indeed can be a great teacher. Let me share with you an article that I ran across entitled Things My Mother Taught Me, to introduce some humor. And unfortunately, the author is unknown, but they certainly encapsulated some things that our mothers taught us as we were growing up. My mother taught me to appreciate a job well done. She told us, if you're going to kill each other, do it outside. I just finished cleaning the house. My mother taught me religion. You better pray that comes out of the carpet. My mother taught me logic, because I said so. That's why. My mother taught me how to meet a challenge. Answer me when I talk to you. Don't you talk back to me. My mother taught me foresight. Make sure you wear clean underwear in case you're in an accident. My mother taught me irony. keep laughing and I'll give you something to cry about. I can identify with that. My mother taught me something about the science of osmosis. Shut your mouth and eat your supper. My mother taught me about contortionism. Will you look at the dirt on the back of your neck? My mother taught me also about behavior modification. Would you stop acting like your father? My mother taught me about envy. There are millions of less fortunate children in the world who don't have a wonderful mother like you do. My mother also taught me about justice. One day, I pray you'll have kids, and I hope they turn out just exactly like you. Well, leaving a legacy by passing stuff on to the next generation can be serious business, but I don't ever want you to forget to laugh, because we need laughter, do we not? The Bible tells us in Proverbs that laughter is medicine to the soul. Well, today we want to look at God's word, and we want to look at some biblical principles that need to be passed on to the next generation. Turn, if you would, with me in your Bible to Joel 1:3, and let's read together what God has given to Joel to share with others. I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. It says this in Joel chapter 1, verse 3. Tell your children about it in the years to come, and let your children tell their children. Pass the story down from generation to generation. What is Joel saying here? Well, I believe that one of the principles that we can pass down to the next generation is sharing God's truths. God is making it very clear that we are to share the truths that God has taught us and pass it down to the next generation. We are not to keep our wonderful experiences of learning God's truths to ourselves. We're missing out on some of the greatest joys for which God created us when we fail to share the goodness of God with others, including the next generation. One of my fondest memories is when my wife and I would read a Bible story and pray with our girls at night before they would go to bed. And as we were there sharing with them, even before they could read, they would take the Bible story and read it to us because they had heard it so many times before that they had it memorized. If you didn't know any better, here was this little three-year-old and you would have sworn that they were reading off of the page in front of them, but they had heard it so many times and they had their favorites. I'm a firm believer that we can never start rehearsing the word of God in the ears of our children too early. It tells us again in the book of Proverbs, train up a child in the way they should go when they are young, and when they are old, they will not depart from it. Friend, you don't have to be a biological parent to pass on God's truths to the next generation. What are some of those truths? God's faithfulness. The fact that God is our healer, that when there is a sickness, the first thing we do is pray and believing for God's supernatural intervention as our Jehovah Rapha, that God will divinely intervene. That God indeed is our God, Jehovah Jireh, our provider, that no matter what the need is, God in his faithfulness will make provision for it. That God is our Jehovah Shalom, God our peace, and Jehovah Sekindo, God our righteousness. And the list goes on and on and on. But rehearsing in the hearing of children the wonderful truths about God and letting them know, not only from hearsay or not only from something that they have read, but they see it being modeled in your life, that you rehearse in their hearing by way of testimony of God's faithfulness to you and to your family and to your children in the past, and passing it down from generation, that has a way of building up their faith, their confidence in God, in knowing that he is ever faithful in their lives. Take advantage of that opportunity and share your knowledge, your wisdom, and experience. Every adult needs to be aware that any time that you are around someone younger, you have the chance to positively influence him or her. Too often, as adults, it's very easy for us to become self-centered, and we have a tendency to focus only on ourselves if we're not careful. How much better it is to focus on others and experience the joy of making a difference in someone's life. Friend, it doesn't have to be your biological child. Understand that God has us as spiritual parents, spiritual mothers, spiritual fathers. And even though your children may be grown and adults and not live close to you anymore to where you don't feel like you have much influence on their lives, be encouraged in the fact that you influenced them when they were young and still at home. And now if you are blessed to be a grandparent, you can influence your grandchildren. But in the meantime, you can be a spiritual parent or a spiritual grandparent to somebody in the church body. Perhaps there's a child there who doesn't have the benefit of having both parents at home. Understand you can make a difference by sharing the truths of God in their lives. You know, there are many young people today who don't have the privilege of being raised in a home that has both parents present, and they need to have someone believe in them, someone to encourage them. You can be that individual that can influence their lives in a positive way, and then they can pass it on to the next generation coming up behind them, just as you spoke into their lives, so they can speak to the generation coming up behind them, and so on and so forth. The second principle, that we can speak into the lives of others in creating a legacy, is to pass on wisdom and knowledge. Proverbs 16:16 tells us how much better it is to acquire wisdom than gold. To acquire understanding is more desirable than silver. The book of Proverbs, which was originally written for the next generation, says that it is better to have knowledge and wisdom than money. And it's better to be spiritually smart than to have material possessions. It's important to get this settled in our minds if we're going to pass it on to the next generation. Too many times we're like the traveler who was between flights in an airport. She went into a shop there and bought a small package of cookies. She then went and sat down and began to read the newspaper. Gradually, she became aware of a rustling noise from behind her paper. She was startled to look up and see a neatly dressed individual helping himself to her cookies. Not wanting to make a scene, she leaned over and took a cookie for herself. A minute or two passed and then came more rustling. He had the nerve to be helping himself to another one of her cookies. Well, by this time, they had come to the end of the package, but she was so angry that she did not allow herself to say anything. Then, as if to add insult to injury, the man broke the final cookie in half, pushed half of it across to her, and ate the other half as he walked away. Still fuming sometime later when her flight was announced, the woman opened her purse to get her ticket. To her shocking embarrassment, she found her pack of unopened cookies lying on top. Suddenly, that changed everything. Here's what most of us are a little confused. From the age of two, whose cookies are they becomes very important to us. Yet the Bible makes it very clear about who the cookies belong. Psalm 24:1 tells us the earth belongs to the Lord and everything in it, the world and all its people. Everything, my friend, that we have belongs to God. Our house, our car, our clothes, our body, and yes, even our cookies. It's all God's stuff. And when we settle this issue, our lives become so much less complicated. How we model this to the next generation is of utmost importance. When we teach them from a young age to see themselves as manager of the things that belong to God, it helps them to live a life that is less stressful, and hopefully we will as well. We learn the importance and the value of sharing rather than hoarding. You know, we're living in a day and a time where people are just going crazy, for want of a better way of putting it, when it comes to purchasing things. I mean, there are so many items that when you go to the store, you can't find. I mean, how much luck are you having right now finding hand sanitizer and wipes and gloves and masks and all the other things that we normally would have in abundance? But because there are people there, and I remember the toilet paper issue as well, although I think that has improved here in a local level. But, you know, it's crazy how you go to the store and it used to have the item right there. Now you've got to go to four or five stores to find things because of people not understanding the importance of sharing. Well, there's a third characteristic that we can hand down as well in creating a legacy, and that is this: character. Now, when you look at the word character, it's important to understand that it's a word that describes such things as morals, as ethics, and integrity. It's about learning how to be the right kind of person and how to do the right kind of things, even when no one is looking. Every generation needs character as a moral compass. Living without character is like trying to find your way around New York City with a map of Washington, D.C. One of the ways to pass character on to the next generation is to protect their minds from evil thoughts. In Proverbs chapter 15, verse 14, it tells us, "A wise person is hungry for truth, while the fool feeds on trash." The old adage is, garbage in, garbage out. What I take in, it's going to have a way of manifesting itself. It's going to have a way of producing things in my life that's going to affect my character, that's going to affect my integrity, that's going to affect my perspective on life. And if I'm constantly feeding garbage in, guess what the outcome's going to be? Garbage out. If we want to keep the next generation from being influenced by negative thoughts, we need to provide a healthy environment for them at home. Moms and dads, teach the importance of media discernment. Monitor, even from an early age, what they're viewing on their computers, what they're viewing on their cell phone, what they're viewing on TV. That we need to understand that today, to be a friend to your son or your daughter will come soon enough. Right now, they need you to be a parent. During their adolescent and teen years, they need you to set boundaries. They need you to establish guidelines. Another way to help your child build character is not to shield them from difficulty. Maturity does not come necessarily just because they're growing older, but rather it comes with responsibility. The Apostle Paul tells us in Romans 5, verses 3 and 4, we also have joy with our troubles because we know that these troubles produce patience, and patience produces character, and character produces hope. While it's true that some people are mature at the age of 17, others are not mature at the age of 37. Why? Because they haven't taken on responsibility. They can't learn responsibility if we are constantly protecting them from times of difficulty. The key to these two character builders is balance. If you go too far to either extreme, you encourage an imbalance in character development. Realize that your child is going to be confronted with unwholesome ideas and suggestions in their lifetime. And our responsibility is to help them to filter through the lures of our culture without overprotecting them. If we're too strict, their spirit may become shattered. Paul warns us in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4, fathers, do not irritate or provoke your children to anger, that is resentment, but rear them tenderly in the training and the discipline and the counsel and admonition of the Lord. Listen, friend. We don't want our children to become bitter. We do not want them to become resentful. So we don't want to come down too hard on them. But we also don't want to become too permissive. If we do, they won't have established boundaries and they may end up becoming involved in behavior that is harmful to them and others. That's good advice for all of us, not just for moms, but it's good advice for every adult interested in training the next generation. Well, I believe the last principle that we need to speak of today, and there are so many that we could stand here all day and share them with you. But the last one is to pass on the principle of convictions and values. Convictions are the values you and I live by, something we won't give up because of peer pressure. Paul tells us again in 1 Corinthians 16, verse 13, he says there, hold tight to your convictions. Give it all you've got. I'm going to say it again. Hold tight to your convictions. Give it all you've got. Character is being right. Conviction is having the fortitude to choose what is right. The greatest joy that you can experience in life comes from making the right choices. When I look through the Bible, there are countless examples of individuals who did exactly that. But one who stands out to me is Daniel. He's a great example of someone who was determined to live his life by his convictions. Most of us remember the story of how he was thrown into the den of lions because he would not stop praying to the one true God instead of to the king. But his conviction to live by his values began much earlier in his life. And I believe it was because he had a godly mother who prayed for him. Daniel and his friends Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego vowed that they would only eat what God had approved for his people, for the Jews to eat, there in Daniel chapter 1, verse 8. He and his friends have been taken into captivity by King Nebuchadnezzar's army to the land of Babylon. But he didn't give up his convictions and values just because he was in a foreign land and ungodly people were in control. We need to learn from his example that we are going to do what God says, and no matter what, we are going to live by that, whether it is easy or not. We can say like Joshua of old, choose ye this day whom ye will serve, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. The thing that's interesting about this, when you read the story of Daniel, you'll find out that Daniel wasn't belligerent. He didn't draw attention to himself unnecessarily, but rather he did this tactfully And as a result of that, God rewarded him for it. God promoted him, and others respected him because he was a person of conviction. Four different kings, when you read through the book of Daniel, you'll find out that he served under four different kings who sought his counsel, and he became an advisor to all of them. So why am I so passionate about conviction? Well, because convictions produce passion. And how many of you would agree with me that passionate people change the world? How do we effectively pass on our convictions to the next generation? Well, I'm a firm believer that convictions must be modeled. They are more caught than taught. Paul, writing to Titus, tells us in Titus chapter 2, verses 6 and 7, it says, "In the same way, encourage young men to be wise. In every way, be an example of doing good deeds. When you teach, do it with honesty and seriousness." If you're passionate about your convictions, others will pick up on that passion. If your life exhibits what you say you believe in, they will know what the true value of your convictions are. Our behavior has an enormous influence on the behavior of the next generation. How are you doing in some of the main areas that it takes to leave a legacy? And I'm not just speaking to moms just because it's Mother's Day today, but I'm speaking to all of you who are adults that may be watching this morning. Ask yourself, am I sharing God's truths with others? Am I sharing wisdom and knowledge with the next generation as I have grown in my understanding of the things of God? You know, I've never seen a time where we are living in a day and an age where people are so Bible illiterate. Things that I was taught from my earliest memories, Bible stories, or what have you, most individuals out here in the public today don't have the faintest idea what you're talking about. Many times I catch myself as a pastor when I'm preaching, and I take for granted that people know these things. And after I'm done preaching, when I'm standing at the door, or maybe sometime when I bump into someone a few days later, they'll tell me, "Pastor, tell me about what you referred to when you were talking about, for example, you know, David and the incident with Absalom, or David and the incident with Bathsheba, or David and the incident with Goliath, or Daniel in the lion's den, or Jonah in the whale, or any of the other Bible stories that we all were raised up with." They have no knowledge of these things. As many of you know, on Wednesday nights, we're doing a thing on end time prophecy. And when we're talking about the Antichrist and the mark of the beast or what have you, I've had some individuals walk up to me and say, "We've never heard these things. I've been in church all my life, but we've never heard these things." Friends, I encourage you, get out the word of God. And when you share the truths of God's word, don't just share something that you've read, but know the reality of God's faithfulness. Know the reality of God's protection. Know the reality of God's presence in your life, that it's something that you can enjoy every day. Share the wisdom and the knowledge that God has given you with others, and be quick to testify of what God has done for you. Look for ways that you can make a difference in someone's life by being an encourager and helping them to know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God indeed has produced character in you. It's a character code that you live with, and also that you are an individual that's going to be modeling godly convictions and values to those who are coming up behind you. If you're not doing these things, I encourage you, there's no better time to begin than today. It's a bit unusual to close a message from a newspaper comic strip, but the Children of Family Circus was once discussing babies, and I came across this. One of the young experts were talking to their siblings, and they announced to them, "Babies are connected to their mothers by a biblical cord." Did you catch that? Babies are connected to their mothers by a biblical cord. May that be true for all of you who are mothers that are watching today. There are so many solid principles for parenting that are found in the Bible that no parent can afford not to know them. If you and I are going to be godly parents, if you and I are going to be godly grandparents, if you and I are going to be godly spiritual parents, spiritual grandparents, be sure to be immersed in God's word, fully committed to the calling that he's given you, that we can leave behind a legacy that will always point others to Jesus Christ. Pray with me this morning, if you would. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you, Lord, so much for the truth and for the principles that are established in your word. I pray a special blessing today upon every woman. Thank you, God, for motherhood. Thank you, God, that you are in control of every circumstance and situation. And as a responsibility comes along, whether it be a biological mother, whether it be a spiritual mother, Lord, whatever the capacity may be, may all women today understand that we honor them, we respect them, we appreciate them for who they are. A wonderful child of God. I pray that today will be a day that's filled with your presence, with your joy, with your love. May we as family members, Lord, allow these individuals to know how much we respect them and we desire to honor them, not only today, but every day of their life. I pray that you'll keep them in your safe and protective care. Give them wisdom beyond their years. And Lord, I pray that you will speak into their lives words of encouragement, that when opportunity presents itself to make a difference in the lives of those who are coming up behind them in the next generation and the generation after that, that Lord, they will be found faithful in proclaiming the goodness of Jesus Christ. Most importantly this morning, if there's someone, Father, that's viewing that doesn't know you as their Savior and as their Lord, I would ask that this very moment your Holy Spirit would begin to deal with their heart. Might they call out upon the name of Jesus Christ, asking you for forgiveness of their sins, inviting you into their life, that they may know the joy of knowing their sins are forgiven and that they're a child of God. This morning, my friend, if you're watching and you do not know Christ as your Savior, I welcome you to pray the following prayer with me. It's a matter of transferring my trust from myself and anything that I can do other than calling out upon the name of Jesus Christ and placing my trust in his atoning work that he accomplished on the cross of Calvary through his death and through his resurrection, paying the debt for my sins, for your sins, for all mankind, once and for all, as we ask him for forgiveness. If you need Jesus this morning, would you pray with me the following prayer? Dear Jesus, I am a sinner. I need you to come into my life as my personal Savior and Lord. I ask that you would wash away my every sin with your precious blood. Write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life and give me this precious gift of eternal life. I thank you, Lord, that you accept me just as I am. And I thank you that you are the only begotten Son of God that takes away the sins of the world. Thank you for hearing my prayer. Thank you for coming into my life as my personal Savior, as my personal Lord. And from this day forward, with your help, I will serve you faithfully. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. This morning, friend, as you prayed that prayer, know that God has heard it, know that God has forgiven you, and that your name is now entered into the Lamb's Book of Life, and you are part of the family of God. Welcome, welcome with a virtual handshake. I welcome you into the family of God today. Get into the Gospel of John and read it. And if you have questions about it, please feel free to call the church, 540-433-8687. We'll be more than happy to talk with you at your convenience, either by phone or in person or whatever it might prove to be, but answering questions that you have about what does it mean now that I'm a Christian? How do I live a Christian life? What does it mean about the baptism in the Holy Spirit? What does it mean about Jesus Christ returning someday by way of the rapture? Friends, there's such an exciting adventure that lies before you now that you've decided to become a follower of Jesus Christ. It's an exciting adventure, and I challenge you today, be faithful in service to God and know that God can anoint you in such a way that you will leave behind a legacy. May the Lord richly bless you. Well, as I mentioned at the beginning of the service this morning, our governor, Governor Northam, announced that churches may reopen on Friday, May 15th at 50% capacity. And as you know, we had a plan of mitigation in place when the virus first hit, and we've been working through that, and we're in the process even now of obtaining clarification of all the specifics for this to take place. We want to assure you that if you choose to come to church next Sunday, you will return to a safe and a sanitized environment. We've already been in contact with folks, and we'll be meeting with others through the week to ensure that when you come, that you will be notified about the mitigation procedures that will be in place, and ask for your cooperation as we navigate this course together. We'll be sending a, a letter out this week and other means of communication as well. And we ask you in advance for your cooperation as we navigate this course together. Look, this is uncharted territory for all of us, and we ask for your patience and we ask for your cooperation. We're going to be doing this in phases, and we ask that you be respectful of others with the precautions recommended by health officials. We'll begin next Sunday by having a 10 a.m. service only, and we'll look at adding additional services in the near future. Now, pay attention. If you have children, we will not be having nursery or children's church next week or maybe over the next couple of weeks, and this is being recommended to us by the district officials in our district just because of wanting to make sure that the COVID virus is under control and there's no potential of anyone becoming infected by that. So we're following their recommendations and what have you, and we will have these things in place hopefully in the near future, but we don't want to rush into it unhurriedly. Now listen, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. We are not operating out of fear. We are operating out of concern for your well-being. Know that we love you and know that we care about you. We want to move forward. And we ask for your prayers that God will grant us wisdom as we continue to move in the direction of having services reestablished. We want you to be assured that your safety is our number one priority. We are going to be doing everything that we possibly can to make it a wonderful experience for you as we're able to meet again in person. But we ask you for your cooperation. Please know that we're not trying to dictate to you different things, but rather in the well-being of everyone that is concerned. Please be respectful of others. And please be respectful of those who are trying to look out for the welfare of everyone that is involved and not just one or two individuals. So thank you. Thank you so much for your faithfulness, the way that you've been faithful in your giving. I cannot commend you enough. Again, on behalf of Stonebridge Community Church and many other churches in our community as well, that are our sister churches and the Assemblies of God that we've been able to help because of your faithfulness, families in the church, individuals in the church, thank you so much for the way that you have responded. And I can't wait to see you next week. Looking forward to a great time of worship and praising and worshiping God. We will continue to do the live stream on both Sunday morning as well as Wednesday evening. So if you choose to stay at home, we certainly understand that. If you are showing any kinds of sick illnesses, please, by all means, stay home. And also, if you're elderly and you're a little skeptical or reluctant or hesitant, we're not going to think any less of you if you take your time in coming back. But please use caution, exercise your wisdom. It's your personal choice. But as we said, we will have a service next Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. We welcome you to come out, but we ask that you be respectful of the guidelines that are in place. May the Lord richly bless you. And again, moms, happy Mother's Day. I pray that this day will be filled with a lot of fond memories in the years to come. And by all means, laugh. Enjoy the goodness of God. Can you say amen? Have a wonderful day in Jesus. We'll see you Wednesday evening, should the Lord tarry. God bless you.